is an Unspoiled Network podcast.
This is Unspoiled, covering The Dresden Files, Book 7, Deadbeat. The last four chapters, I forgot to look up what numbers they are.
40.
There we go. In these chapters, welcome to Unspoiled. I'm rolling thunder, pouring rain. I'm coming on like a hurricane. My lightning's flashing across the sky. You're only young, but you're gonna die. I won't take no prisoners, won't spare no lives. Nobody's putting up a fight. I've got my bill, I'm gonna take you to hell. I'm gonna get you, say it, get you, a hell fest. Welcome to the show, everybody. I'm Natasha.
I'm RoShawn.
So what did you think, lady, of this finale?
Well, it wrapped up much quicker than I expected.
Yeah?
I mean, I knew we only had, you know, it's four chapters, I think. Mm-hmm. But it's like, what is it, 15 pages, maybe?
Is that it?
It's super short. Like, chapter 40 starts on page 477, and... All right, maybe it's like 30 pages. And then it ends on like page 517.
I was listening to the audiobook and I was like, that was way more than like 15 minutes of...
But it's fast, though. I mean, it's four chapters, but it's like 30 pages. That's short.
Right, true.
But yeah, I mean, it's done. You know what? I feel it wasn't that it wasn't great,
mm-hmm.
but it just, and I don't want to say it was rushed, but I do feel a little slightly let down.
How so? I will not be mad at you in any case. Please just tell me what you mean.
I think
I'm here. I'm listening.
It wrapped up. It made sense. But, like, the thing with Morgan, we'll start with the thing that it starts with, right? So right. When the chapter opens, it's Morgan trying to murder Harry.
Right.
Because he's seen, or he thought he saw Harry kill Lucia.
Right.
So, it starts like it's going to be a pretty intense thing. And it is for, like, a second. And then Harry decides that he is just going to sacrifice himself.
Right.
And let Morgan kill him and hope that his death curse is enough to take out at least Gervain. And then at the very last second, it turns out that Lucio's not dead.
Right.
So I don't have a better way for Harry to have dealt with Morgan, but her not being dead, I felt like, oh, that's a little,
Why's that?
And I think it's because one of the things that we've talked about so many times with these books is that oftentimes Butcher doesn't do the thing that you get in so many other stories.
Okay.
And this felt very much like something that I would get practically anywhere else. You know, this situation isn't as bad as this no-win situation is won because the stakes weren't what you thought they were.
I
didn't love that. Even though, and I'm going to contradict myself, I'm tickled pink that she's still alive. Because I loved that character, and I was hoping that I would see more and more of her later in the books.
Mm-hmm.
As we go on, like, maybe some Harry Dresden Warden adventures. So I was glad that she's still around, but it just felt like, oh, that's a little bit of a cop-out. But okay. And then what should have been amazing, which was the Bob save.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't really love that either.
Okay.
And again, it's going to sound like I'm contradicting myself because I'm a big Bob fan. You know, and it should have been the moment where Bob, excuse me, comes back driving Sue. Right. Should have been like a really kind of epic moment. And it just kind of fell sort of flat for me.
Was it because it felt rushed or?
Because I understand that he even makes a point to like explain it to us for those of us who are slow. But the minute Cal puts down Bob, that sort of releases his sort of control over him.
Right.
And it gives us the window that Harry's able to use to sort of communicate with Bob. But Harry is doing a lot of talking to Bob. And I reread it twice because I was like, well, is it telepathic? But no, he's talking to Bob out loud.
Yeah.
With a knife to his throat.
Yeah.
Why wouldn't she tell him to shut the fuck up?
I mean, she could, but then she'd have to kill him because I think the thing, and this is where my argument is that it's really that it's rushed. She could tell him to shut the fuck up, but she has no leverage because they've already argued that killing him right now would be a bad move. So he knows that he can get away with it and she's not going to do anything.
I feel like if she... See, that's where I push back because... And this is a stretch because I don't know if she it seems to me that she should understand what's happening. That Harry is trying to communicate with Bob to have Bob interfere with what's going on.
Okay.
So it would be in her best interest to keep that from happening. Now, if she can't shut Harry up by just threatening his life, which she's already doing, if that doesn't have any weight because Harry realizes that she's not going to kill him, she can pick up Bob.
Hmm.
She can kick Bob like he's a football and punch him over out of the circle. But she doesn't have to just stand there and let this thing happen, which seems like it would be at the top of her list of things to do, which is not let this thing happen.
Maybe she doesn't know how he works.
So this is what I'm thinking. Like maybe she doesn't understand the ramifications of what happens if Harry's able to make this connection with Bob. And that I don't know. Like, does she understand it? Does she not? I don't know. But, so yeah. I think this is one of the first times, too, that an ending has left me a little, like, you know, a little, mm-hmm. like, oh, you know, it's not great. But this book was so good, and I think this is the first time where he has just had so much happening.
Yeah.
Right? There was a lot going on throughout this entire book. So many moving pieces that he just kind of maybe ran out of room, you know? And it was like, oh, shit, I gotta wrap this up.
Right.
As much as I can because I have, like, more stories to tell. So I'm not going to hold it against them, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, Jesus, he even remembered to go back and bring Mava back into the story. So
he even remembered in his own book.
Right. So, but, so yeah, those are my thinking on the all of the chapters.
Okay. I don't think that you're being unfair. Like my main feeling, because this is the thing that I really was struck by, like rereading this, is that it does all feel rushed. Like, from when he gets grabbed to when Bob starts in with fucking Sue, I was like, oh, really?
Yeah.
Already? Okay. Mm-hmm. So that was the main thing to me, was that, like, I feel like that could have been a more as you put it, epic moment if it was given some more space.
Mm-hmm.
But instead, it's like Harry has just talked to Bob like a half paragraph before that.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't get given the time to even worry.
Like, exactly. Like, the last thing he says is he kind of sees Bob going up with all the other spirits. And he says there's a moment where Harry's like, Bob's not going to be able to help me.
Right.
And then he's here helping.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And like the going up with other spirits is so vague
mm-hmm.
that you're not, because he says something like, oh, he must have gotten sucked up. Like, so that was the end of Bob. And we know as readers that that's not going to be the end of Bob.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there's no way that a character that important and powerful is going to get wiped out by accident in this moment.
Right.
So the only way to get us to believe that is to have Harry really like see that and have an emotional reaction and freak out a little. And mm-hmm. he doesn't. He just goes, well, I guess he's gone, and moves right along, which you could argue maybe would be realistic in the moment that, like, he's that distracted. But it doesn't, like, there are so many moments in these books where Harry, in a split second moment, we get four paragraphs of his inner thought process before he does something, even mm-hmm. though the time that's passed is really brief. It's still him making all of these connections really, really, really quickly. So I don't think that it would have been outside the realm of possibility for Butcher to make that a more convincing moment just for a second.
Yeah.
And then, you know, if Bob turns up again, have it be a second, like give it a little bit more room, have all of this sort of happen earlier. I don't know. So yeah, I agree with you on that.
And that's the thing too. Like I can say the critique, you know, it feels very rushed, but then I'm like, well, but when else would he have been able to put this in? Like, he just didn't give himself enough room
mm-hmm.
for this part of the story, because I don't know that I want to see the thing with Bob happen before the whole thing with Lucio happened. So then it's like, you know, but then how would that have worked?
Right.
Like because he runs into them one at a time. First, he runs into Corpse Taker in the last chapters. This chapter, he runs into Gravain before he, you know, and Cal is the last one he gets to.
Mm-hmm.
And it's already been established that Cal is the one who has Bob. So right. How would that have worked if we had seen Bob earlier? You know, I guess it wouldn't have. But I wish that he had found a way to make it work so that there had been a couple of chapters, maybe like one chapter or two, where you're just like, well, shit, I guess Bob's really gone, you know?
Yeah.
Or at least not going to help us out right now. Like, maybe Bob made it safely back to the apartment. Yeah. But he's not here for this fight. And then have him swoop in. I'll tell you what, I knew that we didn't have time for Morgan, but when the chapter opens and Harry is dealing with an enraged Morgan, I could have read a little bit more of that.
Enraged Morgan's pretty fascinating.
Because this was, I had no, Harry calls it earth magic.
Mm-hmm.
And the shit that he's doing.
Yeah, I
was here for this.
That was some serious shit.
And all Harry can do is run. And climb up a tree like a fucking scared bear. Do bears climb trees?
Scared bear.
I couldn't think of any other animal that climbs a tree.
Oh my god.
Blanked.
Did you say, what was it you said, a scared bear, and then you said, do bears climb trees? Yeah, yeah. They climb trees.
Yeah. For a second I wasn't sure, but then I was like, I've totally seen that. I got confused because I think I read somewhere once that, like, if a bear is chasing you, to climb a tree to safety. But bears climb trees, so that's terrible advice.
Yeah, I think that, like, they don't climb super well. And so if you, like, get a tree that's really, what's the word? Like, not going to hold both of your weight, they won't pursue you up there because they realize that. But that's really putting a little bit too much trust in the idea that a bear is going to stop
and consider the weight.
You know, yeah, like, because, like, once they realize that the tree is tipping, aren't they going to be like, oh, perfect, you're going to be right near the ground now, I got you. Like, I would think. Because I know that, like, tying your food up in and hanging it from the trees doesn't always work for that reason, that they climb up and push it down. Like, you know, if there's more than one bear,
oh, they can work as a team. You can't win. Yeah, you're outmatched if they're working as a team.
Oh, my God. What are we? What are we doing?
So, oh, you know who else I enjoyed? I enjoyed Ramirez.
Oh, is he great?
He's pretty fucking good. he was so good, guys. For a second, I got paranoid and was like, this guy isn't who he says he is.
Oh, interesting.
Like, for no reason except that he was just too enjoyable. I kept thinking it was a trap.
That's really funny. you seem a little bit too entertaining and capable, so I feel like that really reveals something about your life. Like, RoShawn, is that what you thought about me? Yeah. Surprise! I rip off my mask.
The end of a Scooby-Doo episode.
Who is somebody terrible that I could have been this whole time?
Practically any other white woman.
I was about to say, like, Sidewalk Susan or whatever the fuck. One of those. Anyway, let's not do that right now. Yeah, Ramirez is really funny. He fucking kills Gravain, which is like, I had forgotten that he gets a kill like Gravain right out of the gate.
It's amazing, too, because he takes his head off and then shoots him in the head.
Yes! Double tap.
Oh, it's so good. And it's, okay, so he gets to ride on the back of Sue with Harry. And he is having the time of his life. He really is. He's like living his very best life. He tells Harry, everybody, he says, everybody who lets me ride on her dinosaur gets to call me Carlos. Which I love that he says everybody, or he's like, because it makes it like, I've got plenty of friends who have dinosaurs and they all get to call me Carlos.
Yep.
excuse me, but he's just full of, like, you know, snappy comebacks and jokes, and he has this fucking line he says that I shouldn't laugh at, where he says, he asks if Kumari is pretty.
Oh, yeah.
And then he's like, because I could just use my Ramirez charm on her, but I have to be really careful with that, because otherwise I might end up in bed with an ugly Kumari. And I should not laugh at that. But I swear to God, I laugh so hard. Oh, and Harry has this moment, too, dealing with Morgan before we get to Ramirez, where he finally realizes that Morgan doesn't have a personal vendetta against Harry.
Yeah.
He compares him to being like a burned out cop.
Yeah.
You know, someone who was very principled and sort of a zealot who, after decades of just seeing the very worst in everyone, become bitter and enraged. And he also says this doesn't make him like him any better.
Yeah, right.
But it just changes the way he sees him.
Mm-hmm.
And that's kind of the moment where he realizes that excuse me, he can't argue with Morgan. He can't convince him. He can't beat him. So he's just going to let Morgan kill him.
Because at least if everybody has Morgan, they still have a chance of stopping this whole thing.
Right.
And fucking Harry in this is like, oh, and also when he kills me, I'll use my death curse against Gravain. Mm-hmm. Like, he is prepping his death curse to help them. Even as he's, like, gonna die. Which is really baller.
Yeah.
In its way.
It's, It's like a, it's funny because he refers to Morgan as being a kamikaze, but what he's planning is the most kamikaze mm-hmm. thing in the whole fucking book, which is he's gonna kind of turn himself into a bomb, you know, and let his death take out one of the bad guys.
Yeah.
And he like lays down his staff and just stands there, but instead, Ramirez shoots Morgan in the back of the leg and blows his knee out. Yikes. Which ended up being kind of bad for like the overall game plan.
Yeah, I get what he's doing here, but it is right. kind of like one of those, right.
But, and so it turns out that Ramirez had heard Harry trying to convince Morgan what happened. And because he's already decided that he kind of likes and trusts Harry, based on like reputation and what he'd seen of Harry at an earlier when Harry was at the White Council a couple books ago,
mm-hmm.
he decides to go after Lucio and he does a soul gaze and confirms that that's her in Corpse Taker's old body.
Right.
And then Lucio starts talking and tells Morgan to fucking stand down. And then that whole crisis is averted.
Yeah, what did you think of that body snatch dealy? Like, we knew that had happened, but now that she's going to live.
That's weird because she's in this whole new body now mm-hmm. of who knows who this body belongs to.
Yeah.
But I guess it's hers now. And I think... Because it did never occur to me that she was going to live, I hadn't thought about it. But now that we know she's alive, I guess I was a little surprised that she has to stay in this body.
And they can't, like, turn it back?
Yeah, I guess, I guess there's no undoing that. Or maybe there's magic that can happen later at the council or something, but it sounds like this is just what it is now.
Mm-hmm.
That must be... weird.
Now, remember I had told you about some people were getting irritated at how much we brought up the descriptions of women in mm-hmm. these books.
Mm-hmm.
And I had some people, you know, making the argument like there are some unattractive women in the story and yada yada. This is an example of what makes me angry, because Lucia was a badass older woman
and now she's just in a young girl's body.
Mm-hmm.
I can't remember what this girl looks like.
She's like got like curly brown hair and dimples, and she's not like super hot, but she's like cute.
Mm.
And it just bugs me. I'm just gonna say it.
Yeah.
Like, we just can't, you know, like, we've had a couple of women who were specifically described as not being that attractive, one of whom winds up dying, and it's an honorable death in sacrifice to her friend, the half-troll, mm-hmm. Is it Myrtle? What is her name? I know it starts with an M. Oh, it's gonna drive me nuts. And, and then there's Dumpy Joan, who winds up with the porn director.
Mm-hmm.
And nobody ever considered that he was in love with her.
Because she was just so not, you know, unremarkable.
Yeah. And this just, like, you know, the emphasis on appearance with, like, it just feels so one-sided. We don't have, like, and I understand that it's the point of view of Harry. If a man is not attractive, chances are Harry's not always going to be like, wow, dumpy dude, huh? You know, I understand that. But it's really hard to not be irritated when there's an older, severe woman who's really tough and has, like, earned her stripes. And has iron gray hair and this sort of, like, I always imagined her as being like Madame Hooch
mm-hmm.
from the Harry Potter books. From the movies, rather.
That's good.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
and to have her picked up and put in a young woman's body.
Yeah.
It just bums me out. Like, I would have really liked to have a woman that's not in the camp of the other cuties.
Right. I think, guess. Too, like, when I say that I look forward to Lucio as seeing her in the coming books, I am still thinking of her as the way she was introduced.
Mm-hmm.
And I hope that if we do see her in the future, it doesn't become like a shtick that, you know, she's this grizzled, experienced, you know, warrior who has to, you know, that people are seeing as this cute, dimpled little girl, you know, and that she doesn't get taken seriously as she used to, or that she has to, like, compensate for her appearance. I hope that isn't how it goes. You know what I mean? Like, I don't...
I do, yeah. I obviously can't say anything about that. Oh, yeah. But yeah, I get what you mean. So, yeah, I just wanted to, like... I understand people being irritated with us focusing on that, but I just really can't not. Like, it feels like an extremely legitimate criticism.
Mm-hmm.
And I understand that maybe this sort of thing doesn't stand out to other people as much or isn't as important to them, right, as it is to me. But it's the kind of thing that, as I have continued to podcast and cover more and become more sensitive to, like, specifically how men portray women when they write, it's sort of at front and center now.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I wish it wasn't, because I don't want to view everything through this lens. It's no fun for me either, spoiler alert, but it's there, you know, and I that's just all there is to it. And
right,
and we can talk about, like, well, there have been other unattractive women, yeah, and they're not around. They last for a book.
Right.
The hot ones are around. And they stay. A lot of the time. And
so far,
it doesn't feel like that's accidental. So.
Yeah, I mean, I'm like, I'm imagining, you know, say this were something that was serialized for television or something, right?
Mm-hmm.
You would literally have an actress of a certain age portraying her. And then she would get replaced.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, what that's what's happening.
Yeah.
And that would suck. You know, it's just like, oh, well, you know, you can't have her on screen for too long. Nobody wants to look at that. Let's what can we do about this as they wave at the, her whole thing?
Oh, my God.
So, yeah, so she convinces Morgan that it's really her, and he stands down, and then they regroup. Butters is going to stay with Lucio and Morgan, who are both injured. Butters wants to get into the fray.
Yeah, you know, about
He's about that life now,
mm-hmm,
but he has to stay back, and it's Ramirez and Harry and Sue that go in for Gravain, who right, is surrounded by his horde of zombies, but he's upgraded. And these zombies are a little bit sturdier than the ones that had been outside of Harry's apartment.
Mm-hmm.
Harry says that it looks like they could have been saved if there had been a snappy EMT on the scene.
That's a good line, isn't it? I really like that one.
I enjoyed it too. And Sue really does make light work of it, but she is becoming, like, more bloodthirsty by the moment.
Mm-hmm.
And Harry's having trouble controlling her and directing her. And finally, he has to just kind of be like, well, I'll lean into the bloodlust.
Yeah.
And they get to Gravain, and like you said already, they jump off of Sue, and Ramirez ends up killing Gravain. Because Harry is, like, on the bottom of being dogpiled by a bunch of zombies. And I'm pretty sure he gets bitten as well. Though it doesn't seem to mean anything. So, yeah, like, it's not like Walking Dead.
Yeah, there's no infection happening. Yeah.
And then finally, they end up facing cow. And he's the last man standing. He's, you know, fucking doing the thing with the vortex, the Dark Hollow. It's all coming together.
Mm-hmm.
And then he puts Bob down, and that lets Harry get a chance to get in Bob's head. And then Bob comes in on Sue.
On Sue. In Sue.
In Sue, that's right. Yeah, she's and that, like, disrupts the whole spell. Harry gets a chance to knock Cal on the head with his staff.
Mm-hmm.
And that's it.
Yeah.
Like, that the spell's disrupted. The whole thing's, like, a wash. And Harry, like, passes out.
Yeah, Harry's, tapped.
Yeah. It's, what happens to the cow? Because we don't see them. Right? Like, and even Harry asked, like, are we sure that they're dead?
I'm trying to find the exact spot. You're going to kill thousands of innocent people. Kumori, yada, yada, yada. Bob winks at him, which is hilarious to me.
Yeah, he turns his, like, orange eyes real quick and then turns it back to blue.
Tyrannosaur Bob let out a bellow and swiped one enormous talon at Kumori. Cal's apprentice was tough and competent, but no amount of training or forethought can prepare you for the sight of an angry dinosaur coming to eat your ass. She froze for the briefest second, and I turned, shoving away from her. The knife whipped against my throat, and I felt a hot sting. There was no more time. I flung myself across the grass, gripped my staff, and swung it like a baseball bat at Cowl's head. The vortex abruptly screamed and filled with a furious red light. Blah, blah, blah. There was more sound and blackness fell. Yeah.
That's it. When he wakes up, he asks them, I think it's... Well, when he first wakes up, the first thing he sees is the fucking Earl King.
Mm-hmm.
And he's tickled. He is amused by all of this.
Yep.
And he kind of just gives Harry a pass because he appreciated his, what did he say?
Arrogance?
Yeah. He says, and you please me with your calling of the old hunter. But he tells him, you know, be careful because next time I see you in these streets, it's on.
Right, yes.
And then, so that takes care of the Earl King, which was a big concern because it was pretty clear that regardless of how this worked out with Gervain and Cal and Corpse Taker and the spell, Harry was going to have to reckon with the Earl King, right? And that was, a thing was looming pretty heavily over the whole shebang.
Mm-hmm.
But even this turns out, he's like, meh, it's fine.
Yeah, I feel you about
it's
that.
It's fine, you know. So, and again, I don't have a better suggestion. I don't know what Butcher should have done. I'm not a writer. I don't know. But I'm just... But again, it just felt like, you know, it was a lot of build up for something that just ended up being like, oh, you wacky mortal. You gave me a chuckle, so it's fine.
Yeah, I think that, like, it's not really an excuse, but I think it's important that so much of what Butcher does is play the long game in a lot of these. So, like, some of them are not going to have the same, like, explosive ending. Mm-hmm. But this one was literally explosive. But you know what I mean.
Right, right.
Because he's having to leave so many doors open.
Right.
And I think that's a little bit of, like, a hindrance as much as it winds up being some of what you like about the story.
Well, yeah, because I feel like the Earl King is something that we might possibly see in the future.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, obviously he can't just kill Harry now. Or could he? Or you know, could he? I mean, like, you know what? Like, I have been saying more often than not that I knew blah, blah, blah wasn't going to happen because Harry can't die. But I'm starting to feel like that is not going to necessarily be true. forever.
Why is that?
Because the longer we go, I'm starting to wonder if we will have a situation where Harry does die, but then somehow comes back. And I'm not sure what that looks like.
So a Buffy situation. Spoilers.
Possibly, yeah. Something along those lines where I don't think he'll be reanimated like a zombie, and I don't think he'll necessarily, like, become a vampire. I'm not but, you know, magic is on the table. Mm-hmm. And in each book, Harry becomes more and more powerful. And each book, it seems like his foes are more powerful. Like, each book is bigger, you know? And the stakes are higher, and the type of magic that seems to be at play is bigger. Like, this book was almost like making people into gods, you mm-hmm. know? So I'm wondering how, like, I feel like it can't be too long before we get to a point where the magic is so big and so expansive that life and death become things that aren't, like, final, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And again, I don't know really what that looks like exactly, but I just feel like, I feel myself, like, opening up to that possibility.
Do you think that would have anything to do with the coin?
Well, that's the thing, too. Like, that is something that's in play now. And you know what else I thought about? It doesn't have anything to do with this book, really, but it has to do with the coin. What is Harry going to do when he sees Michael next?
What is he going to do?
I don't know. Like, Harry hasn't fully accepted the coin, but he has accepted a little bit of it.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if that's the sort of thing that Michael will know just by being in Harry's presence. Will he be able to tell? Or is it a secret that Harry will have to keep from them? And if so, for how long can he pull that off? Does this, does Harry having the coin and having this, even though it's very, you know, tentative, cooperation with Lashiel, does mm-hmm. that automatically make Harry sort of an enemy to Michael? It kind of, like, you know, it kind of, a little bit. I don't want to see that. I don't want that. Yeah, but that's for a later book.
One question that I have always had at this point in the story, what I was asking was, okay, so Harry doesn't want to take up the coin, but he has an impression of Lashiel in his head. If he doesn't want to take up the coin, just give it to Michael.
Like, tell Michael to come get it?
Yeah.
Out of the basement?
Like, when they beat the hell out of What's-His-Face, they took the coin and, like, put it somewhere safe.
I don't know why he didn't just do that in the first place.
This is my question. Like, if you really don't want it, then you really don't want it.
Right. Well, he tells us, though, like, well, his other him told us, boy, you always knew you wanted that coin.
Mm.
Don't even play. You knew you wanted this fucking coin. You wanted it to be available to you in case, like, just in case things got bad enough. And that's why you didn't tell nobody to come get it. But see?
Yeah.
What does he say on his grave? Because there's a whole thing, too, where when he finally has to give Mavra the book that he take. I love how he takes the book off of the Gravain's body. Or is it Cal's body?
It's Cal's body.
Cal's body.
Sure, yeah.
And he, like, but he makes sure no one's looking. Like, who the fuck is around?
Mm-hmm.
But he, like, takes it, you know, and sticks it in his pocket so he can give it to Mavra. And this confrontation they have where he's all, if you threaten anybody I love again, I'll murder you.
Yeah.
But he still gives her the book.
Yeah.
Why?
I don't really know why he still does that, like...
I don't understand it either.
I guess because he's back to worrying about Murphy again because everything else has been taken care of. Like, before it was like, well, I can't give it to her because she'll become a dark goddess. But now the Dark Hallow, I guess, can only really be performed at Halloween. But, like, you know, a year from now, is she just going to show up again?
So, and like, he comes on so, you know, I'll be the worst thing that ever happened to you. I'll hunt you down and whatever. And she's shook. So, he could have just...
She's shook, like, she isn't at first. She's shook once he's like... Oh, no, I will find the power, and I do not care about right and wrong after a point.
Doesn't he tell her he has the Fallen, like one of the Fallen at his disposal?
He doesn't specifically say that. He just says, like, I have a demon. Like, he phrases it. I'm trying to... Let me find it. Personally, I'll pick up every weapon. Okay, here it is. Oh, yeah, here it is. No, you're right. He says, I've got a fallen angel tripping all over herself to give me more power. Queen Mab has asked me to take the mantle of Winter Night twice now. I've read Kemmler's book. I know how the Dark Hallow works, and I know how to turn necromancy against the Black Court. So once again, let me be perfectly clear. If anything happens to Murphy, and I even think you had a hand in it, fuck right and wrong.
Mm-hmm. Now, this whole big declaration is after he's given her the book and she's given him whatever these incriminating pictures are.
Right.
So I guess you could say, well, he has to give her the book to get the pictures.
Right.
I guess. But, I don't know.
Yeah. I'll tell you what. This is the thing that, that Owen really has a problem with this book. He likes this book, but he doesn't consider it one of his favorites because of this part.
Hmm.
Is her, him, like, caving to Mavra and being at the same time, like, well, you can't do this again. Yeah, but you did exactly what she asked you to do.
Yeah, yeah.
So, like, why is... You can threaten her all you want, mm-hmm. but she knows it worked, so... Yeah,
why wouldn't she try it again?
Yeah.
So, yeah, that this doesn't feel quite right to me either, this whole thing. Like, he could have just... choked her out and took the picture. But okay, it's fine. It's fine. Do we know what these pictures are? Did she tell us at the beginning of the book? I can't remember.
He sees them and they're all of Murphy, like going about her daily business. Oh no, wait, no, it's not going about it. They're all of Murphy and they're of the vamp fight where it looks like she's just shooting fucking civilians with like a...
Right, that's right.
Okay. Because they're Renfields and, gotcha. You know, thralls okay. and whatnot.
Okay, all right. So that big standoff happens and, you know, she disappears. And then he has this moment with his father. And they talk about the death curse on Harry.
Mm-hmm.
And about being afraid to die alone.
Mm-hmm.
And how Harry's grave says he died doing the right thing. And his father gives him kind of a pep talk, you know. Mm-hmm. Says, you know, everything isn't just black and white. And even though you did this thing and, it, you know, you made this sort of... You took this help. That doesn't determine who you'll ever... You know, who you are and who you'll be. You still have a choice in that.
Right.
You can still choose to... I guess be a good person. I guess.
I guess.
And his dad tells him that everybody dies alone. So
don't feel bad about that. He says everybody dies alone, but it doesn't mean you've got to be alone before you go through. And believe me, you aren't alone on the other side.
I guess that's sweet.
And that's when Harry says, really? Like, because, mm-hmm. you know, he doesn't really know anything about the other side. And his dad just says, cross my heart.
So I guess that's good to know. I don't know. But that's my own shit. I'm not going to get into all that.
Yeah, I mean, the general statement of you're not alone on the other side could really be taken any way you want.
You know, like, because he's not clear about what else is happening on the other side.
Like, I mean, he could be like, you're not alone on the other side, and then his eyes glow red and you know, fangs extend, exactly. And you're like, oh, God.
It could be a whole bunch of people that Harry killed waiting for him on the other side. That technically qualifies as not being alone, but it doesn't make it a good situation. But since his dad is trying to comfort him, I guess this is supposed to be good. And then finally Murphy comes home and her arm is broken. So yeah. what was she getting into?
Is it broken or?
She's got a cast on it. I mean,
Murphy showed up to chew me out for the wreck. When she saw me in bed covered in bandages, she stopped in her tracks.
Yeah. It says she has a cast on her left arm as if for a broken wrist.
Oh, yeah, there it is.
And he thought he saw the edge of a bruise on her neck.
Yeah, what do you think?
Rough sex? I don't know. Mm. I mean, I guess her and Kincaid could have got into some, you know, some shit that popped off in Hawaii. But they didn't go there for that. So, yeah, I have no idea. I guess they accidentally ended up dealing with some shit. I don't know. I mean, I don't know. I don't know. I've got nothing, guys. I really don't know.
Well, interesting. So she's like weird. Yeah, she doesn't want to tell him. There's also Thomas, who missed it all.
Like her bike didn't work or something. He couldn't get there in time.
And like you didn't even notice he was missing, right? Mm-mm. That's not just me. Like you're just like, oh, right.
Thomas. I forgot he was supposed to meet him there.
Exactly.
Just remembered that he was supposed to get a message to them at the hotel. I forgot that he was supposed to show up for the fight.
Oh, bless him. And let's see, what else?
Everybody goes back to his apartment, years. Lucio and Morgan, and then some other White Council people come, some healers come to take them off somewhere. He has a moment with Morgan where Morgan kind of begrudgingly admits that Harry might not be a despicable, evil person. He's just arrogant and dangerous and undisciplined. So it's like the worst apology in the history of apologies.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't think you're malicious. I just think you're dumb and bad at things. Oh, okay, thanks.
Yeah. I don't think you're dangerous because you're evil. I just think you're dangerous because you're inept.
But I cannot in good conscience condemn you for it without giving you some sort of chance to prove me wrong.
And he's going to be in charge now while Lucio recovers. And he tells Harry that he can't undo Harry becoming a warden. Like, that's just the thing that it is now.
Mm-hmm.
But he's not going to be sending anybody to help Harry. And also he admits they can't spare anybody anyway.
Right.
But he does say that Ramirez has basically requested to,
to run Los Angeles.
Yeah, to be like in America, to be like around.
Right. What about when Harry takes out a penny to drop on the floor after Morgan apologizes?
Oh my god, to check to see if gravity is still a thing.
He's such a fucking pain.
And he gets a check. How about that? The mm-hmm. Being a warden is a paying gig.
Yeah.
Which really surprised me.
Same. And like he says, it's not like, it's not a fortune, but it's enough to make him blink in surprise.
Mm-hmm.
So that's good news.
Right, considering that he does still need to try to keep some of his bills paid.
Mm-hmm.
And then Butters brings him a guitar, and there's a moment where Harry's able to perform some magic with his hand.
Yeah, how about that?
Yeah, his bad hand. So that's promising.
I like that moment.
Yeah, yeah.
And he tells Butters, actually, I think you're a pretty good healer. And Butters says, you think so? And I glanced at the warm, steady flame of the candles and smiled. Yeah.
Yeah. That was a nice way to end it.
Yeah. Agreed.
So there's that.
Because Butters is the MVP.
He really is, guys. He's like the Neville Longbottom of these books.
Oh, that's such a good description of it, though. It's really true. I'm sorry. I'm just like, that's just really given me so many ideas and crossover, like illustration ideas and whatnot. All right. So, RoShawn has proven guilty in hand, everyone.
I do. Got it today.
Yep. So that shit's going to be starting. And like, as much as I have a really special place in my heart for this book, and it's in many ways my favorite, Proven Guilty is super good.
Oh, good.
Super, super good. And it probably objectively is better than this book. So I'm very excited about it.
Oh, wow.
I'm just always excited about these, pretty much. So I don't, there's like one book that we have yet to read that I remember just being kind of like, okay, well, and it might, there's a lot of times where I feel that way reading something on my own. And then once I start to discuss it with somebody, I realize that there's a lot more there than I really gave it credit for, you know?
You have any interest in telling me which book?
No, I don't want to influence you. I don't want to do that. But I am hopeful that, like, once we get there, at least, even if it doesn't make me necessarily like the book more, that it will give me some different appreciation for it. Because it really is, like, when I re-listen to a lot of these, which I do frequently, that is not one that I go back and re-listen to.
I'm curious.
I've only listened to that audiobook, like, twice. And
what's the next one called? Proven Guilty?
Yes.
Ooh. What could that be about?
What do you think? Any guesses? Do you want to put something out there?
Proven Guilty. Well, I don't know. I'm thinking maybe it does have something to do with the coin and Michael and all of them. I mean, it could be something completely. I never do well with these titles. I don't think I've gotten it once.
I'm trying to think, like, yeah, because Dead Beat, what was the one before this? Blood Rites. And that was obviously like Harry finding out about Thomas.
Mm-hmm.
But of course, you know, we think it's like black magic or something. So yeah, I guess not.
Yeah, so I don't know. It's on its face, it sounds like, you know, a trial of some sort. Somebody's mm-hmm. going to be accused of something and will have to, you know, defend themselves. And if that's the case, then I can't think of anything other than, unless, I mean, my first thought would be, some of Harry's choices in this book seem like that's something that could have him dragged in front of the White Council.
Mm-hmm.
But then I'm like, they wouldn't dare after what just happened.
Because they can't afford to lose anybody.
They can't afford to lose anybody. And like, they didn't have anything to offer. And yeah, he broke, you know, necromancy. He kind of tried to wiggle through on that very small little loophole that he found.
Mm-hmm.
But to try to bring him up on charges for that just seems like it goes against everything we just read.
Right.
So the only other thing I can think of is the coin and whether or not it becomes known that he has it and he has, you know, accepted help from Lashiel. But you know what? It's going to be something that doesn't have anything to do with any of that. It's going to be something that I did not think of and never saw coming, because that is how it goes.
That is true, though.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, boy, guys. Guys, I'm so excited. Ah!
Oh, what if it has something to do with... Nope. Nope. I was just thinking,
good talk.
What if it has something to do with the Murphy and those pictures and all that shit? Like, what if the next book is more focused on Murphy, since she wasn't in this book hardly at all?
Interesting idea.
Maybe not something as literal as her getting in trouble for the pictures, but maybe Murphy related.
You know what I'm realizing, actually, is that there might be a short story that happens between this book and Proven Guilty. So I'm going to look into that tomorrow just to double check that there's not something that we want to stick in between.
Okay.
Because there may be. So, because I feel like this is around the time in the, like, grand scheme of the story that stuff begins to happen for other people. Because a lot of times the side stories are other POVs. Although most of them are still hairy. So I will have to look into that. Cool. And if anybody wants to offer me some insight on that, feel free. I know a few of you have gotten in contact with me in the past about that, but it's been a while and I get a lot of messages, so it's hard to find things after a little while. So on that note, you can message me on the Facebook page at facebook.com/unspoiledpod. You can hit me up on Twitter at @unspoiledshow, Instagram at @unspoiledpodcast. The email address is unspoiledpodcast@gmail.com if you want to go the traditional route. And the website is unspoiledpodcast.com. Somebody mentioned the other day, like, they messaged me on Twitter and they were like, do you know your website is a sporting goods website? And I was like, what? And it turns out they were going to, like, my old, like, personal website. And since I'm changing my name, it doesn't, like, I let it lapse because I wasn't going to use that name anymore. But they gave me a real good scare because I thought something happened with my website again, because that is a fucking theme for me. And we don't have any new reviews on iTunes. So I guess nobody likes us and nobody listens to us. And we can just go straight to hell. So good to know. And thanks, everyone, for hating us so much.
And being so committed to hating us, too.
Hating us so, so much. It's just palpable. And we will cuddle it and suck its warmth. I really don't know why I phrased it like that. Suck its warmth. That's like some sort of horrible euphemism. She sucked his warmth. Like, oh, I take it all back. Forget it. You guys are right to hate us.
This is why we don't have any new reviews.
Toodaloo, motherfuckers.
Bye, guys.